want to thank those who invited me to come and speak today. Sort of, it is always a chance for me as the chair of the Diocesan Property Committee to let you know how to get a hold of us and when you should get a hold of us. I do have to confess that when I saw the two topics upon which I'm speaking today, property and standards, and historic and designations and status in the context of creative care, I was taken back. I had to stop and be creative. Our property is, to a large extent, buildings, fixed and mostly solid, of venerable age, and there's really very little interest in changing them. The major struggles are to have non-leaky roofs on them, external cladding that doesn't look too bad, and to maintain a heating system that keeps parishioners more or less comfortable on most Sundays of the year. If parish corporations can do that, most parishioners are quite happy. And if you're looking for a standard, that seems to be it. Weather kept on the outside, heat on the inside, and a decent looking barrier in between. When we look at the other aspect, which is historic designations, we do have a lot of history, give or take a few. We have 153 churches, 50 halls, and 67 rectories at last count. And their ages are spread over the last 226 years as follows. Of the 153 churches, there's one that was built before 1800, 95 of them between 1811 and 1900, another 35 between 1901 and 1950, a further 17 between 1950 and 1999, five during the last 14 years, and we do have another five that are unknown vintage. I can't find out where they are. The 50 separate halls, or 11 of those that were built between 1850 and 1899, another 16 between 1900 and 1950, 18 between 1950 and 1999, and three over the last 14 years. We did better with halls. We only have one of unknown vintage. Of the 67 rectories that we have, there's two rectors living in buildings that are built before 1800, 22 between 1846 and 1899, 13 between 1900 and 1950, 25 between 1950 and 1999, and five during the last 4 years. That's just the buildings. And of course, our history, thank God, is not just about the buildings. It's even more about the people who have and are worshiping God, have and are having fellowship with one another, and who have and are caring for souls in the parishes. Certainly, creative care demands that we have a better standard than if it's just standing, more or less there, solid, leave it alone. Certainly the compilers of our canons that go along with our 2003 Anglican Church Act and the Diocesan Synod, which accepted them, thought so. They have provided us with a standard, at least for rectories. Regulation 7-3, just to quote the bureaucracy, titled Housing Standards and Moving, And section 4 states that new buildings, additions, or alterations must comply with any applicable municipal, provincial, and federal laws. And without limiting the generality of the foregoing, lawyer must have written this, the owner shall ensure that the plans meet the standards set out in the current edition of the National Building Code of Canada. That same standard does apply when parishes apply to the bishop through the Diocesan Property Committee for permission to modify existing or constructing new structures. And that brings me to answer that question as to what I was asked even just this morning. When does a parish have to refer work they are planning to do to the property committee? What the canon says is that if there's structural change involved, then the bishop's permission is needed. In other words, if you're taking off an asphalt roof and putting on an asphalt roof, you really don't have to come to us to get permission from the Diocesan Property Committee. But on the other hand, if you're taking off an asphalt roof and putting on an insulated roof on top of another roof and then putting steel on top of that again, yes, the Property Committee wants to be involved, because we want to know that the extra weight involved in putting that extra structure on top, that you've actually checked to make sure that the building will in fact withstand the extra weight. There is no really black or white written criteria as to when you have to come to the Diocesan Property Committee, other than if there is a structural change, then the bishop's permission is required, and how you get that is by applying to the Diocesan Property Committee, who considers your application and then makes a recommendation to the bishop, who then writes a letter to you saying yes or no. On the other hand, it doesn't hurt to ask. I can assure you that we in the Property Committee are not just looking for work to do. I got enough to do without sort of going and debating about what you need to know, what you need to do to put a new roof on or not. But there are gray areas, and it's those areas that it is worthwhile discovering. Like we've been asked about the possibility of removing pews in one church and moving chairs. Seems an innocent enough thing. But what you have to ask is, well, have you actually had the structure to examine so that you know that the shift in weight dynamics that comes by having chairs as opposed to pews, that the floor will actually support that? One church discovered that no, it wouldn't. They're still using pews. The simple thing is that pews actually spread people out. You can't all get in one huddle, but with chairs you certainly can. So the simple thing is ask, and I certainly will be glad to tell you, no, I don't think this needs to go through the proper committee, or yes, we should have that. And this does bring me back to this matter of communication and standards. And there are really two ways of looking at them. One is to see them as an expensive nuisance to be circumvented by shortcuts and make do solutions whenever possible, and that basic thing, don't ask till afterwards. It's better to pay the fine than ask and then say, have the questions, answer, no, you can't. The other is to see the standards as an expression of care, as a way of ensuring that what we construct is safe and durable. And that simple creative change of the way that we view standards from being a hindrance to helpful guides. It enables us to give expression to the standard of care under which we all, as Christians, live. And here I'll be a little bit of my other occupation I had for 35 years, and that is, it brings us to a creative understanding of what our Lord Jesus was able to sum up of all the law and the prophets in that golden rule, which you find in St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 7. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Now, I've heard this said, that such piety is being so heavenly minded that you're absolutely no earthly good. My response is that unless you are heavenly minded, you are no earthly good. Being Christ-centered in our care, including the care of property with which you as members of parish corporations and as parishioners have been entrusted, does not make the decisions you have to make any easier. In fact, it will often make them more difficult. The question becomes, do we repair, refurbish this property, or do we decide that it's time to let it go either by selling it or demolishing it? That is an agonizing decision. Likewise, changing the way parishioners do ministry so that the grace of God can work through them to rebuild a long-time diminishing congregation so the place dedicated to the worship of God can be full again. That is even more difficult, as we all know only too well. However, the good news is that our history tells us that by the grace of God, neither of these is impossible. With a history that goes back to Jesus and through him reaches back a couple more thousand years, we do have a lot of it. Most of it, of course, has to do with people, their relationship with God, and their relationship one with another. Now, what is an interesting question, one that might be worthy of a book, is why it is in the latter portion of the 20th and this first portion of the 21st century that we as a society are trying to freeze a portion of our history, the part that is carried in our buildings, at least in certain buildings, either because of their location or because of certain features found in them and on them. Here in New Brunswick, we have not one, not two, but three different designations by which a building can be basically frozen in time. The first is municipal. There are certain areas which have been designated as municipal heritage conservation areas. And the practical consequence of such a designation is that any change to the exterior of the building will have to be reviewed by a heritage committee, which determines whether the change is in keeping with the architectural history of the area, and they can direct that the proposed changes need to be made in a way that is in keeping with that history. For example, when the Canadian Bible Society in St. John needed to repair their front entrance, they had to do away with the existing doorway that had been put in maybe 30 years before. It was one of those aluminum full glass doors, and they actually had to replace it with one that looked a lot older, even if it was in fact newer. Likewise, when Trinity Church in St. John wanted to build a handicap access ramp to one of their doors as part of their renovations, they had to undertake to clad the exterior wall of the ramp with rock that complements that which the surrounding walls are constructed. And that list can go on and on. In Fredericton, The cathedral, the O'Dell House, the Cathedral Hall, Bishop's Court, and our Diocesan Synod office are all in a historic area, which means that changes have to be reviewed by the Heritage Board here in Fredericton. So we have this one level of municipal, which basically municipality defines an area as being a historic area, and then changes in the are ones that are subject to being under the control of a historic review board. Another level of historic designation is provincial. Under the Heritage Conservation Act, which is Chapter H4.05, which was assented to in February 2010, and administered by the Minister of the Department of Tourism, Heritage, and Culture. Under it, and this was a change in 2010, under it, anyone in the province may apply to the Minister to designate any place in the province as a provincial heritage place or a local historic place. Now, there is some good news in the sense that the latter designation does not impose any restrictions or obligations on the owner of the property. So if you're designated a historic, local historic place, you can sort of go, whew. Under this act of statement of significance is developed for a provincial heritage place. And that details the unique character-defining elements of the place. There is a requirement placed on that site that a permit will be required to alter any of the character-defining elements. Now, if it's not listed as a character-defining element, then yes, you can change it without going to the Minister of Tourism, Heritage, and Culture to get permission. And there are if you go to their site and work through, there are actually forms that you fill in to get permission to change any character-defining element. The third level of historic designation is that of a national historic site. This is a place that has been designated by the Federal Minister of the Environment on the advice of the Historic Sites and Monument Boards of Canada as being of national historic significance. And it's Parks Canada, a federal agency that manages the National Historic Sites Program. As of April 2012, there were 965 National Historic Sites in Canada. There are 167 of them administered by Parks Canada, and the remainder administered or owned by other levels of government or private entities, including the Diocese of Fredericton and parishes within that. Now, the standards and guidelines for National Historic Sites are found in a 300-page document entitled Standards and Guidelines for the Conservation of Historic Places in Canada. How you find it is, where you find it is on the board, sort of the, and likewise the other references are the ones I referred to as I've been going through this talk. There are legal requirements which go with sites designated under this as historic under both the municipal and provincial designations. It's less clear, at least as far as I can determine, if there are legal obligations under the national designation. But if you're going to bear the name, then you should be prepared to play the game. And there are certainly moral obligations obeying the standards and guidelines if, in fact, you're going to bear that name of being a National Historic Site. And one would expect that you would, in fact, follow the guidelines and standards that are set up for that. Now, along with these, sort of, we do have other obligations in our diocese, how we are going to administer our buildings. That's under Diocesan Policy 83, the sale, purchase, and renovation of parish property. You have to get the bishop's permission and Senate's permission before encumbering any real property holdings. And this includes being designated a historic site nationally, provincially, or municipally. In other words, if you're going to contemplate getting a historic site designation, you need to ask the bishop's permission. Now, it's also the reality that a few of any of these designations give any significant financial support to the body granting it. It's a little bit of a burr under my backside, if I may put it that way, that our national organizations, and even our provincial organizations, and our municipalities want people to preserve properties, keep them in one particular, and it does cost more to do that without really giving any financial support to it. Now, it is the case that, and it's the very character of the Diocesan Property Committee, that it hears of instances where parishes and churches have experienced difficulties with being an historic designated site. Things are going well, we really don't hear about it. However, it has heard of enough difficulties that it's recommended to the bishop, and he has concurred that there is a moratorium on the bishop granting permission for a parish to encumber itself with a municipal, provincial, or historic site designation until the diocese develops a policy regarding such designations. With roughly 145 churches, 30 halls, and 25 rectories of an age, and with a history that puts them in running for a historic designation, we need to determine what criteria we are going to use that will permit them to be so encumbered. Creative care does require that we are responsible in how we encumber our properties, just as it requires that we pay attention to the standards we have, such as referring changes in structure to the Diocesan Property Committee, such as the sale, purchase, and renovation of parish property, Policy 83, Policy A8, which has to do with minimum insurance standards, and Regulation 7-3, which is housing standards and moving. Most of these are found on our diocesan website. All you have to do is work your way down through it, and that is what I have done in giving you the URLs that will actually get you right to each of those different documents. I do hope that has been a little bit of help.